Hallelujah. Well, I believe you're in the right place at the right time this morning. If you will, stand to your feet with me in honor of God's word. Turn with me to the book of Mark, chapter 6. Mark, chapter 6, verse 4. As you're finding your place, I'll tell you of a preacher I heard about. He went out bear hunting. He'd always wanted to shoot a bear. So he goes out. He's been hunting all day. Ain't seen anything. He gets hot, frustrated. Puts his gun down, walks down to the stream to cool off just a little bit. Those of you who's hunted before, sometimes frustration sets in when they don't see anything for a while. He gets frustrated, goes down, cools himself off at the spring. Suddenly, he sees the biggest grizzly bear he's ever seen in his life. It's about 100 yards away, and that bear is running full throttle at him. He takes off as fast as he can. He ain't got his gun. He knows he can't outrun this bear. So he falls to the ground, and he says, "Oh, God, would you convert this bear into a Christian bear right now? I'm about to die." And without anything said or done any further, all of a sudden that bear, within 10 feet from getting on top of this man, stops, throws his hands up, and says, "Oh, Father in heaven, thank you for preparing this meal that I'm about to partake of. In Jesus' name, amen." Amen. Well, miracles come in all shapes and sizes, don't they? Amen. Mark chapter 6, verse 4. "But Jesus said to them, 'A prophet is not without honor except in his own country, among his own relatives,'" look out, family, "'and in his own house. Now he,'" capital H, Jesus, "'could do no mighty work there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and he healed them. And he," Jesus, "marveled because of their," say that with me, "unbelief. Then he went about the villages in a circuit teaching." In a circuit. He had to step outside that place for one reason. His power was shut down for one reason. Because people, the closest people to him, his family, his friends, the city, he couldn't do miracles because they didn't honor him. They didn't honor the gift, the anointing, the power that was upon his life. And because they didn't honor him, he could do no great miracles. This morning, we're going to talk about a few things. And I think it's fitting for this season in our lives. Just for text purposes, because we're going to get there. Would you flip over, hold that place. Would you flip over in Numbers chapter 12? I don't think I've ever preached this passage, but I want to draw it to your attention in Numbers chapter 12. And I'll throw a little line in here. Brother Jason Crabb will be with us here live January the 8th with his band. And if you've never heard him live, you don't want to miss that. Okay? He's excited. He might even get him a Texas deer while he's here. I don't know. We'll see. But you don't want to miss that night. It'll be Sunday night at 6:30. Please start telling people. We will start spreading the word on social media. Numbers chapter 12, verse 1. "Then Miriam and Aaron spoke against Moses because of the Ethiopian woman whom he had married. And he had married an Ethiopian woman. So they said, 'Has the Lord indeed spoken only through Moses? Has he not spoken through us also?' And the Lord heard it." Somebody say, "God heard it." I like that. I caught my attention. "And the Lord heard it." You can't say anything without God hearing you. "Now the man Moses was very humble, more than all men who were on the face of the earth." Wow. "Suddenly the Lord said to Moses, 'Aaron and Miriam, come out, you three, to the tabernacle of meeting.' So the three came out, and then the Lord came down to the in the pillar of a cloud and stood at the door of the tabernacle." It's interesting where he positioned himself. "And he called two people, Aaron and Miriam. And they both went forward. Then he said, 'Hear now my words. If there is a prophet among you, I, the Lord, might make myself known to him," watch, "in visions. I speak to him in dreams. Not so with my servant Moses. No, he's my friend. He is faithful in all of my house. And I speak to him face to face. Even plainly. Ain't nothing hid at all. Because he's just a good friend of mine. And then he says, and not in dark sayings. And he sees the form of the Lord. He's seen my glory. Why then were you not afraid to speak against my servant Moses? So the anger of the Lord was aroused against them, and he departed. And when the cloud departed above the tabernacle, suddenly Miriam, somebody say Miriam, became leprous as white as snow. Then Aaron turned toward Miriam. There she was a leper. So Aaron said to Moses, "Oh, my Lord, please do not let the sin lay on us in which we have done foolishly, in which we have sinned. Please do not let her be as one dead, whose flesh is in half consumed when he comes out of his mother's womb." And so Moses cried out to the Lord, saying, "Please heal her, oh God, I pray." Then the Lord said to Moses, "If her father had, but this was a custom, spit in her face, would she not be shamed for 7 days? Let her be shut out of the camp 7 days, and afterwards she may be received again." So Miriam was shut out of the camp 7 days, and the people did not journey until Miriam was brought in again. And afterward, the people moved from Hazeroth and camped in the wilderness of Paran. This morning, I want to speak to you from a subject simply this: disconnect from disrespect. Disconnect from disrespect. The person you're sitting by right now, you may not be able to sit by them anymore after this message. I'm sorry. Father, we love you. We thank you for your word. Thank you for your anointing that accomplishes that it's sent out to do. We give you the glory in Jesus' name. Somebody say amen. All right, you can be seated. But Jesus said unto them, "A prophet is not without honor except in his own country, in a place of familiarity." A spirit of honor is what God looks for when he's ready to promote a man or woman, a boy or a girl. When he's ready to take you to the next level, one of the qualifications, I believe one of the major qualifications he's going to look for is, are you a man or woman of honor? Now, before you give your list of reasons why you're honorable, I want you to think about some things. If you don't have a spirit of honor, it will really affect the status of how you walk with God. It does matter when you give respect and when you don't give respect. It does matter if you honor someone, whether you feel like they should be honored or not. It does affect, and this goes for me, it goes for you, it goes for the church as a whole. I feel like it is important that if in this new season, how many understands anytime there's an ending of a thing, there's a beginning that's going to come back. The scripture says that the latter shall be greater than the former. And what that simply means is that God takes us from glory to glory, from faith to faith. We should always be getting better. We should always be progressing, not degressing. Our church, our family, our children, your finances, you shouldn't, your how you say, your temptations. You shouldn't still be struggling with some of the same issues that you've struggled with 20 years ago. Why? If you're growing in God, if you're being respectful, if you're being honorable, and your character has progressed, God should have helped you by now. You should have such a relationship with Jesus that the things that used to knock you down don't knock you down anymore. You might stumble a little bit. You might trip up a little bit, but they ain't knocking you down anymore because you've become, you've recognized greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Somebody say amen. Do you have a spirit of honor? That's the question today. Do you have a spirit of honor? Not just for yourself, because we all like to honor ourselves. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, now introducing to you the greatest man or woman living alive, and we'll put our name right in that plug real easy. We never have a problem introducing ourselves. But when it comes to honoring people, when it comes to honoring teachers, preachers, and how you say, pastors, when it comes to honoring mothers and fathers, and when it comes to honoring husbands and wives, when it could be honoring a boss. Listen, it could be honoring a president. Let me tell you something. I'm going to give you plenty of scripture. But none of us have a right to disrespect or dishonor or tear down or talk about the office of the presidency. It's wrong. I've been convicted after studying this and preaching this message. I really didn't want to preach this message because of this very place. Because I know I've spoken against my president. But I'm telling you, there's curses that come on our life when we disrespect, when we dishonor people in authority. It's wrong. And we're going to have scripture today, not of just a sermon, but of a message where we can grow and learn how to, listen, whether you're a child, you should be able to get through this message that as a child, you should honor mom and dad. You should respect them. And if you're older and you have mom and dad, you know what? We all need to recognize and be reminded that mom and dad birthed us. And had they not got together, we would never even be here. So they deserve our honor and they deserve our respect. God longs. He commands us to be men and women of honor. And I believe it's important. Listen, we do live in a generation where it has become popular to be rude and dishonoring. Where's my son at? My daughter. We live in a generation that thinks it's okay to be rude and dishonoring to people in authority. When I was growing up, this wasn't too long ago, in my generation, if you sucked your teeth, you might not have no teeth left by the time daddy got done with you. If you rolled your eyes, that's the last time you got your eyes may get stuck rolled. I'm talking to you, Haley. That's right. We live in a generation that thinks it's okay to be disrespectful. And mom and dad has let it go on for too long. But we're going to see today that disrespect and dishonor, listen, it does not help. It does not, it may make you feel good right at that moment, but it is not going to fix your situation in the present circumstance. It's not going to fix it. We must learn to be respectful. Listen, honor, write this down. Honor is an attitude, and then it becomes an action. Let me explain. For some of you, you come into church, maybe this church, maybe another church. And your attitude is, man, I just can't like, I don't like the praise worship. I don't like the preaching. I didn't get nothing from that sermon. Can't believe they preached that message. It was horrible. Didn't like anything about it. And the problem is not the message. It's not the singing. It's not the praise and worship. It is your attitude. It's the disrespect and the dishonor that you have portrayed in coming out of your mouth. Not anybody else's. You're the only one saying it. God can't move on disrespectful people. He'll never honor people who are dishonorable. You say, but I've been doing this 20 years. Take your 20 years and fly it up a kite, fly it up a pole. It ain't going to get you anywhere if you're not honorable to people who are in places to be honored. Someone said, well, they don't need to be honored. Well, then you need to go to God about it. Because if it is your pastor, if it is your boss, if it is your president, if God... I'll show you scripture. If God, there's no one who holds a position or office except for it's been given by God. Where's promotion come from? You sure? Didn't come from a man? No. If you believe your Bible, the Bible says promotion comes from the Lord. So if they've been given that position, Saul probably wasn't the greatest one that should have been chosen in authority, but yet God handpicked Saul, who stood head and shoulders above all the people. You remember the story. And he gave them what they were asking for. But then when Saul couldn't cut it, he had to find another man. Who'd he find? He found David. How did he find David? Because he looked for a man whose heart would be humble, whose heart would be honorable. Even so much to the fact David's heart was so honorable was when Saul would try to kill him 3 to 4, 5, 6 times, David would still walk in humility. And when he should have and could have took his life many a times, David refused to touch God's anointing. Amen. Jesus is saying in our text, in this particular text in Mark chapter 6 verse 4, he's saying, my power is limited around certain people who don't honor me. When they don't honor others, they're not honoring me. And And through their disrespect or through their dishonor, it's shutting off my power. It affects my anointing. Do you get that this morning? It's important you don't dishonor men and women of God, whether you like them or don't like them. For this reason, there may come a day after your life is turned around, when you need the person maybe you've disrespected or dishonored, whether it's mom or dad or anyone else, it may come a time where you need their gift. You need their power. You need the anointing on their life. But because of disrespect and because of dishonor, it won't work. Jesus couldn't do miracles. They brought the blind, they brought the lame, they brought the sick, and there was many who couldn't get healed at that season. Why? Not because the person who needed healing had done anything, but because the people in the crowd, they didn't believe. They were disrespectful. They were dishonorable. Anybody getting this morning? Does it make sense? God's word teaches we must be honoring to people. Watch this. The person sitting beside you deserves as much honor as the president of the United States. The person sitting on the other side of the room, whether you like them or don't like them, deserves as much respect as your pastor. There's no big I's, there's no little U's. At the end of the day, the buck stops with God. And you know, one of the Ten Commandments makes it real clear, you better love your neighbor as yourself. And I know every one of us love ourselves pretty darn good. So we got to love even when we don't feel like loving. Sometimes it's not, like I said, it's not easy, but it's required. Let me give you some more scripture. Romans 13:7 says it like this. Billy Dalton, you can throw it up there for me. Render therefore to all their due. Taxes to whom taxes are due. Look out, somebody, you got to pay them. I know you don't like the IRS, neither do I. Let's get in line. But we got to honor. We got to pay our taxes. Customs to whom's customs. Fear to whom fear. Honor to whom honor. Romans 13:1. Let every soul be subject to the governing authorities. Every soul be subject to the authority, governing authorities. For there is no authority except, look at there, from who? From God. There is no authority except from God. For there is no authority except from God. And the authorities that exist, listen, are appointed by God. Do you see that? I don't think I've ever seen that scripture. Romans 13:1 makes it real clear. If someone's in authority, they were appointed by God. And it is our responsibility to honor God. That service. Now, I want to jump to Numbers chapter 12. We read, and I want to draw your attention to this story. Everybody say Miriam and say Aaron. Now, this was Moses, this was his brother and sister. Their family must have been really, really gifted and talented. God used that family in a great way, which goes to show you God can use families to work together. But it doesn't mean you're not going to have some bumps in the road. And they had a bump in the road, okay? God had delivered 2 million people out of bondage from Pharaoh. Y'all remember the story. They crossed over the Red Sea, okay? Y'all with me? They walked over on dry land. Now they're out in the desert, and they're about to start their journey. And as soon as things start happening, the devil starts messing. You know what? Like they say, when God starts blessing, the enemy starts messing. That's what happened. And here's Miriam, the sister of Moses, and Moses gets hooked up with this Ethiopian woman. She's got a little color. He's white, she's black. And Miriam don't like it. I think all of us ought to have a little mixture of color tied together. Moses hooked up with some chocolate. He liked it. And praise God for that. But Miriam didn't like it. And you would think that it's none of Miriam's business, wouldn't you? But like many of us, we got something to say when we don't like it. If we feel it, we're going to say it. And that's what old Miriam did. And so she gets all spiritual And she can't keep it to herself. She got to involve somebody else. So she says, hey, Aaron, is God only speaking to Moses? Is God, I mean, he's done got himself a woman, thinks he's somebody. I think we've been part of this thing ever since the first day of the ministry. What's she doing? She's dishonoring. She's disrespecting. She's talking about God's anointing. And it's so amazing. I mean, this story just looks like a reality show. It's like it's up on the screen, and it really paints a picture of today, how people do. And when somebody does something that you don't like or I don't like, we got something to say about it. And we think it's okay because we can just say whatever we want to say. But I'm telling you, it's affecting our families. It's affecting our anointing. It's affecting our children. What we say and how we treat people will affect the growth of this church. And I'm going to dig deep this morning. Pastor, I got your permission, don't I? Thank you. We're going to dig deep this morning. Because if we don't ever root out things in our lives that are wrong, listen, we can never grow and get better. Say amen, somebody. Let's use Miriam as an example. We won't use you, okay? Let's use Miriam as an example. Here's Miriam. She's speaking against God's anointed. Then she gets somebody else on the same bandwagon. Sounds like gossip, don't it? And this gossip starts spreading. As soon as it gets spread, God says, I ain't waiting for this to go any further. I'm going to confront this right now. Moses didn't confront it. Because this was his sister. This was his brother. He's trying not to, you know, cause any family fights. Because there ain't no fight like a family fight. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Pans and pots and doors and everything else. It's vacuum cleaners start getting thrown. Y'all don't look at me like you saved. You know what I'm talking about. And so Moses, he's just like, ah, it's going to be okay. I'm not going to worry about it. They can talk about me all they want. And the Bible says in verse 6 or 7, it says that Moses was one of the most humble men. That's what it meant. Moses, he wasn't going to mess with it. He's just going to leave it alone. God said, no, this is a problem, and I'm going to deal with it. And he goes to Moses, to Miriam, and to Aaron. Everybody say Moses, Miriam, and to Aaron. You ain't going to forget this. And the Bible says he talks to them and he says, hey guys, I want you to meet me at the church. And they get to the meeting. They show up. They're ready to go sit down in the office and have God sit down and talk to them. And God says, no guys, we ain't going inside yet. The Bible says he meets them at the door. As if to say, the junk you got in your heart ain't allowed in this house. And before you go in this house, we're going to deal with the stuff in your heart. We got to start recognizing that letting stuff come in this house affects this house. And when we got problems or issues in our heart about people, about family, about friends, about enemy, when we start talking about it and creating a big mess, it does nothing but create dishonor in the whole body. And what was once your opinion now has become a way of life. So God dealt with it at the door. And he says, Aaron, this is awesome. He says, Aaron and Miriam, step forward. Yes, sir. I can only imagine that Miriam and Aaron think they're about to be promoted. They're probably ready to accept the crown. Yes, Lord, how can we be of assistance to you? But God exposes their disrespect, their dishonor. Do you see the importance of this? He exposes it. He says, Miriam, Aaron, do you not know that when prophets are in your atmosphere or around, he said, I give them dreams, I give them visions. But with Moses, I come down from the throne room of heaven and I meet with him every day, face to face. I don't just give a vision. I don't just send a dream. I speak to Moses with an audible voice. He's seen my glory. He's seen the very vision or the shadow of who I am. No man's ever seen that. And then he says, did you think that the dishonor and disrespect that you would have for this man was going to fly with me? He says, as a result of your disrespect and dishonor, Miriam, because it started with you, right now you got leprosy. And boom. Pew. She was white, and she got so white, it was the ashy white. I mean, she was white. She done spoke against his color. Didn't like the Ethiopian, so he just gave her double what she thought was so good looking. And leprosy overtook her body. Then the Bible says Aaron and Moses start repenting on behalf of Miriam. God, please don't take her life. Now I want you to notice this. In verse 14, 15, or 16, it says that instead of removing the leprosy immediately, God looks at Moses and he says, Moses, had her dad, her earthly dad, spit in her face, she would have to be removed from the camp for 7 days. So he says, I tell you what, we're going to isolate her. We're going to separate her from the camp. As if to say, I don't want anyone associating with anybody disrespectful or dishonoring to the people that I have put in position of authority. Can I tell you something, church? If you're hanging out with friends or people that's tearing down your boss, you go to dinner and you go to lunch with them and they just keep running their mouth about your boss, what God's saying is you need to disconnect from disrespect, because it's going to affect you like it affected Aaron. It didn't start with Aaron, it started with Miriam. And it's not going to go unseen. God will deal with it. We must be a people of honor. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 9, verse 20 through 26, for sake of time, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but let me paint you a picture. Even in Genesis, here's Noah. Funny story, actually. How many days was Noah on the ark while it rained? 40 days. Then the Bible says for another 150 days, the ark floated. All right, so it's on the water and they can't get out. So what's 150 plus 40? I got any mathematicians in here? 190. Good job. 190 days. Noah is on this ark with his family and them stinky animals. I'm sure after 190 days, they couldn't tell if it was the animals or their family that stunk worse. I don't know. But for 100, somebody say 190 days. For 190 days, the family is together stuck on this boat. And as soon as he gets off the boat, the Bible says in Genesis chapter 9, verse 20, the first thing that Noah goes and does is goes and gets drunk. Which to show you, family could drive a man to drinking anytime. I don't know. Somebody say that's wrong. He gets drunk. He goes in his tent. And he's naked. And his oldest boy, Ham. If you name a son, don't ever name him Ham. That's like, you might as well call him Pig, you know? Ham comes up in his tent while he's drunk and naked. He sees his dad in a place of vulnerability, in a weak place, in a messed up situation. He walks out of the tent, and the first thing he starts doing is running his dad down. Hey guys, guess what I saw? I done saw dad naked. And it was the funniest thing I ever seen in my life. Starts making a joke. What's he doing? He's disrespecting. He's dishonoring. This is in your Bible. Read it. Genesis chapter 9, verse 21, 22, 23, 24, 25. And all of a sudden, the two brothers, their names are a little bit harder to say, so. But the Bible says that the other two brothers, Japheth, thank you, and Shem, they were bothered at how Ham handled what was being said about their dad. So they decided to do something about it. The scriptures say that Japheth and Shem go to their dad's tent in his drunkard stupor. And they don't walk up in the tent. The Bible says that they turn around backwards. And they said, "Dad, where you at?" And they find him without looking at him. And they take this cover and they place it over the dad so that they could honor him and not dishonor him. In his weak moment, in his moment where he made a mistake, made a wrong choice, they didn't like the way it sounded coming out of Ham's mouth, being disrespectful and dishonorable to their dad. So they said, "No, we ain't letting that get out. We're going to honor him. Even if it doesn't seem like he should be, we're going to honor him anyway. And we're going to cover his weakness." And I want you to see what the Bible says. Scripture says in verse 20, "And Noah began to be a husbandman, and he planted a vineyard. He drank of wine and was drunken, and he was uncovered with his tent. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father, and he told his brethren without. Shem and Japheth took a garment, and they laid it upon both their shoulders, and they went backwards and covered the nakedness of their father, and their faces were backwards. And they saw not their father's nakedness. And Noah awoke from his wine and knew what his younger son had done unto him. And he said," listen, "cursed be Canaan." Now I want to stop right there, because he doesn't say cursed be Ham. This is very important. God doesn't curse Ham. I've heard it preached that way. He curses Canaan, which was Ham's son, which would we all know as the Canaanites, which would be one of the greatest enemies of the children of Israel in the years to come. Why? Because of the disrespect and the dishonor of the father of that son to his dad. What I'm telling you is, when we are disrespectful and dishonorable to those in authority or anyone that we come in contact with, we may not be the ones that pay for it, but our children will be affected. You run your church down, your children are going to hear you. They're going to run your church down too. You run your pastors down, you run your boss down, you run your brother, your sister, your aunt, your uncle, your mom or dad. It's going to spread, and you're not going to pay the price for it. Your kids are going to pay the price for it. Church, we must be honorable. We must be respectful. Before I ever get in the pulpit to preach, God always preaches to me first. And many of you know I've been in business for quite a long time, and the Lord has blessed me. He's been faithful to me. He's helped me. I'm not the brightest one in the bunch, but he's given me a lot of good people to help me do what we do. I'm just going to be vulnerable and open with you today. God had to deal with me on honor and respect. He had to take me back in his word and say, "Hey, son, even though you may think they deserve it, vengeance is mine. I'll take care of that. You just keep letting my glory shine in your life." And what I thought was such a small thing, I kind of put it underneath the rug and didn't worry about it. And the Lord came to me in a dream just a week ago. And he had to show me where Daron, this is wrong. And you need to make it right. There's a man I've been doing business with. And it was a business deal. And he didn't like me. So he chose to do something that I didn't think was right. So I, in return, decided to do something that I felt like he deserved. And in that dream, God showed me and that man sowing seed and planting grass together for some reason. And then he showed me and him laughing and cutting up and playing in the rain. Lord, what are you saying? And out of that vision, that dream he gave me, conviction fell on my heart and said, you've dishonored. You've disrespected. And if you don't want it to affect your family, I want you to make it right. Me and this man have gone into a legal battle. Never intended it to go that far, but did it. And I had to call this man and say, you know what? I apologize. I want to make it right. I want to honor what you and your family do. And I want you to know, I'm sorry. And on the other end, I could hear tears coming down his eyes. And that man, who I didn't think was very humble at all, began to say some kind words to me too. And God began to teach me that it's not my job to fight the battles. It's his. And when we honor those in authority, he will honor us. The testimony of out of that, 2 days later, I got a phone call from two contracts. Actually, one contract I've been working on for a year and a half, and they just wouldn't give it to me. And out of the blue, they called me and they said, Daron, we got our money. We're ready to start the job tomorrow. I said, what? Who is this? He said, this is Tom. Come see me today. I'm ready to sign the contract. I said, what job are you talking about? He said, I done forgot about it. But the Lord don't forget. And when I got there, I signed the contract. Big factory being re-roofed. And he said, hey, by the way, we're fixing to throw up another building out back. And we were fixing to give the contract to somebody. But do you do these? Do this? And I said, does a duck swim? And before I left there, I signed two contracts with two jobs. They had to pay me up front to start. In a season where we probably need it the most, because so much goes out to bless my employees and all the things that we do. This is what I'm saying. God knows how to promote when we line ourselves up with what he wants us and how he wants us to live our lives. There may be some things he's trying to get to you, but he'll never get. God, he could have gave me that thing. It was a year and a half. I had the date on the contract in my computer. A year and a half prior. I wanted it then. God said, no, I ain't giving it to you. Because you're going to need to be reminded in a season of your life, how to make things right. So maybe there's some areas in your life that you need to look at. Boys, girls, moms, dads, well, you've been disrespectful, you've been dishonoring, you've said some things you shouldn't have said about somebody they don't even know you said it. And I'm telling you, if you'll make it right, gotta make it right. I got four things I'm just going to run through real quick, and we're going to be done in 3 minutes. You ready? Four or five things here. God scripturally says it real clear. We must honor. First of all, we are to honor the Lord. Everybody say, honor the Lord. Jesus and his presence should always be honored above and beyond anything and everything every single day. Can you lift your hands, close your eyes, and honor him right now? Father, we honor you. We love you. Thank you, Jesus. John 5:23 says that all should honor the Son just as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Proverbs 3:9 says, honor the Lord with your possessions. Here's tithes and offerings. And with the first fruits of all your increase. Okay? It does matter if you honor God with your tithes and offerings. You try to rob from him or from pastor or from the church. You're not robbing pastor or the church. You're robbing God. You're dishonoring the Lord. And he says, I won't have it. Hebrews 2:9 says, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he by the grace of God should taste death for every man. 1 Samuel 2:30, wherefore the Lord God of Israel saith, I said indeed that thy house and the house of thy father should walk before me ever, but now the Lord saith, be it far from me, for them that honor me I will honor, and they that despise me shall be lightly esteemed. 1 Samuel 2:30. Number two, we are to honor the elderly. Somebody say amen. We are to honor the elderly. It should be an honorable thing to grow old. But we live in a generation where when we get old, people just forget about us. They throw us to the side. But God says you better honor the elderly. Proverbs 16:31. Let me give you some hope for you elderly folk. You worried about your hair turning gray? The silver-haired head is a crown of glory if it is found in the way of righteousness. That gray hair you got, God said, I'm showing glory on your life. Hey, be glad you got some. Some of us are wishing we had more. Isaiah 9:15 says, the elder and honorable, he is the head. The prophet who teaches lies, he is the tail. He's saying you must honor those that are elderly. Number three, husbands, listen, men, we must honor our wives. Look at her. She's the best looking thing you got. You can't run over her. You can't trample her. You can't step on her. We must honor our wives. Take her to dinner. Open the door for her. If you can't afford 12 roses, go buy one, you cheapskate. Honor her. Feed her dinner sometimes. Make dinner yourself. Don't go in the house, throw your feet up on the couch and say, hey, honey, bring me some iced tea. Do something different. I bet you'll get something. Honor your wives. 1 Peter 3:7 says, husbands, likewise, dwell with them with understanding. You might not understand them, but you got to dwell with them anyway. Dwell with them with understanding, giving honor to the wife as the weaker vessel. He's never met Abby Farmer. You're not the weaker vessel. I want you to know that. But I'm to honor her. I'm to encourage her, build her up, tell her how beautiful she is. Say, baby, you're looking hot today. Love your hair. Your makeup's beautiful. Wow. Did you lose weight? That always works. Be honorable. Don't look at her and say, man, that sure makes you look a little bigger. Don't say that. Don't say that. Honor her. All right. I like the last part. It says, and as being heirs together of grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered. You know what that says? That says when we don't honor our wives, men, I never caught this. When we're not honorable to our wives, our prayers are affected. It's very humbling. Number four, honor rulers, pastors. That's what he's saying. 1 Timothy 5:17 says, let the elders who rule well. Let the pastors who rule well be counted worthy of double honor. Not just honor, double honor. Especially those who labor in the word and doctrine. People who speak and preach and live the truth. They're worthy of double honor. I'm not telling you to try to come kiss up to your pastors. I'm not saying that. I'm saying if they're doing right, if they're living right and preaching the truth, you shouldn't talk about them. You shouldn't run them down. You shouldn't tear them down to your people, your family. You should be honorable to them. Double. You got family members who preach the gospel. Quit tearing them down. Be honorable to them. The Lord's going to bless you. Number five, honor your parents. Your mother and your father. Ethan and Haley, you better listen to me. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise. With a promise. What's that promise? It says that your days may be long on the face of the earth. You want to live a life where you can get gray hair? You better honor your mom and daddy. Stand to your feet with me this morning. Listen, I went a few minutes over. Here's my heart. My heart is that we as moms, dads, husbands, wives, sons, daughters, we start getting it right. I could have come up here and preached a message that had you on your feet shouting glory, thank you, Jesus. But I really feel like the Lord's trying to get us prepared for a new season. Somebody say, I'm not staying where I'm at. And I'm not going back to where I was. But I'm moving forward. There's some things you're going to have to disconnect from. It may be disrespect. It may be the way someone's lifestyle is. Because it's affecting you. It will affect you. There may be some things that you need to change personally. On a personal note. Let's look at us for a moment. Let's look at our heart. Let's search us. Let's be real. If you're in here and you got it all together, why don't you raise your hand? Yeah. You know what that says? That says we've all probably talked about somebody or disrespected someone. How many knew that dishonor really affected you that much before today? Did all of you know that? Or did some of you say, I learned some things this morning? Yeah. So the Bible's real clear. I learned some things too. Can you bow your heads with me? The Bible says if we honor the Son, the Father will honor us. So here's the first call. Sir, ma'am, young man, young lady, if you haven't honored Jesus as your Lord and your Savior, I want to give you an opportunity right now to make things right with Him. I want you to, on the count of three, I want you to raise your hand and I want you to simply, you're saying, I want Jesus to be honored in my life. I want Him to be my Savior. I want to go to heaven knowing He saved me, forgave me of my sins. That's what Jesus came to do. He died for you so that you could live. The greatest thing a man could do is lay his life down for Jesus. Come on the count of three. One, two, three. You say, I want Jesus. There's a hand. There's a hand. There's a hand. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for this honesty. You can put that hand down. Now, if there's somebody else in here, you say, you know what? There's some things there's some people I've been disrespectful to. They don't even know it, but I've talked about them. I've said some things. There's been some words that's come out of my mouth I should have never said, and I want to make it right. And I want to start by making it right with God. If that's you in here, I want you to throw your hand around. One, two, three. Come on. All over this building. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. If you raised your hand, you said, I want to give my heart to the Lord. I want to make some things right before God. I want you to step out of your pew right now. Come on, let's be honest to the Lord. Come on. Come on, put your hands together. Come on, they're coming. Come on, young lady. Come on, sweetie. I saw you in the back. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Hallelujah. Come on, the Lord knows. The Lord knows. You say, I want to give my heart to Jesus. I'm not ashamed of it, not afraid of it. Yeah. You know what else I'd like to see happen? As she comes. Come on, give this young lady a hand. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, baby. Come on, baby. Hallelujah. Come on, sweetie. Jesus is the best thing that could ever happen to you. And you've made a walk of faith because you're desperate for a change. Here's what the Bible says in Romans 10 and 9. It says, if you will confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, two things, Jesus died and rose again. Listen, you will be saved. Salvation means Jesus applies the blood that Jesus shed 2,000 years ago is applied to your life spiritually and covers every sin that you've ever committed. And you become white as snow. So today, as we, family, we stretch our hands towards you. Lift your hands for me this morning to the Lord. Say this prayer with me. Say,